Hi everyone. So before we start, I have a special announcement to make. So we found an iPhone and a purse. So if that belongs to any of you, please collect it from the registration deck. So with IT enabled innovation, a competitive differentiation for almost all types of sizes and the organizations, agility in delivering IT systems, and ability to run them reliably and cost effectively is critical. This importance gives rise to the DevOps. So with that, let me welcome all of you to DevOps session. So we'll be having pretty interesting topics throughout this session. So we'll be talking about Kubernetes, Docker, CI/CD, and then finally the observability in DevOps aspect. So to start with the first presentation, let me invite our first presenter. He is Lakmal Warusawithana. He's a senior director, cloud architecture at WSO2. With over 15 years of industry experience, he is a pioneer in open source, cloud, and DevOps technologies. Currently, he is the co-architect for containerization and deployment orchestrations for Ballerina. So without further ado, let me invite Lakmal Warusawithana to the stage.
Hi, good afternoon. OK, before I start, let's see how many of work on Docker in your day-to-day. OK, then Kubernetes. Okay, a few, right. Okay, so in old days, we install our application on top of bare metal machine or maybe a virtual machine, right? Then if you want to like scale our application, we need to either get another machine and install it, or we need to spin up a virtual machine and set up our application and run that. But now, we want to run our application on containers. So the main the motivation of running as a container is container like a lightweight, and it can fast boot up, and it is easy to orchestrate, and it is in the, when you come to operation aspect, it is easy to manage. So when you talk about containers, yeah, Docker is the main the technology coming into our mind. So that is the dominating technology in container world. A few other technologies also there. So Docker provides easy to use packaging model to bundle our application, right? So we can, either developer or the either ops person can bundle application with the, all the configuration and the, all the dependencies that required for that application, and all together create a binary package that is called Docker image, and we can run this image as a container in anywhere. I mean, anywhere means like a Docker support platform. So it gives the universal packaging model to run maybe in the dev, test, staging, production environment across the with the same image. And the benefit is like with this all the bundling, all the configuration and dependencies, we can use the immutability in the operation. So that's a very cool thing to have. Like if you used to have operation, you may come across when you want to roll back different version. If you can't have immutable servers or immutable containers, it will give you a hard time. When you are running an application in a container, so one best practice is to run a single process in a single container. Yes, we can run multiple processes in a single container. Then the benefit that we can get from the container, it is dilute, because when you are running a multiple processors in single container, you can't control these processors. But if you're running a single process in single container, you can control the resources allocated to that process by controlling that Docker container itself, right? But when you come to the reality, you can't run the general purpose application in a single process, right? So that means you need to have, since we are advocating not to run a multiple process in the container, so we need to have a multiple containers. So that means, so even with this disaggregated architecture concepts, so the microservice concept, so we need to have maybe 10 or 100 of microservices need to be there for running a single application. That means we need to have some kind of the management capabilities when you are running the containers. We should have some kind of orchestration capabilities and the management capabilities we should think about when you want to run a containers. So that's where the Kubernetes coming into the picture. So Kubernetes is an open source container orchestration platform that you can, it help to automate your deployment, scalability, and the high availability in your containerized applications. So this Kubernetes project is now very mature. So it was started like 4 years ago. So all the Google experience are put into this project. So Google is running container more than a decade. So they use the system called Borg. So all this work experience they put into this open source project called Kubernetes, and all other people, right, Red Hat, Microsoft, and other companies are joined, and this is like a mainstream open source project in this industry. Okay, so if you look at the very high level, the architecture picture in the Kubernetes, so user can interact with Kubernetes. Kubernetes has the control plane, that is Kubernetes master. So users can interact with control plane by using either UI or either from the Kubernetes CLI. So it is an API call, master has the API server. So user can hand over the workload to the master, then master can do the scheduling of this workload across the Kubernetes work cluster. Right. So if you look at, so user doesn't want to know anything about how many nodes running in the cluster, what are the OS behind that cluster, what are the kernel version behind that cluster, but what user want to know is just pass that payload, so Kubernetes master should be capable of running, schedule this workload in the their working cluster. So this is very high level view. So let's look at few Kubernetes primitives, then try to understand how we can map these primitives when you are thinking about deploying application in the containers. So one is a concept called pod. So pod is the smallest unit in the Kubernetes, that is a scalable unit in Kubernetes. So pod can be a single container or multiple containers. It's a group of containers. So I said that, so normally when you are thinking about the real world applications, you can't run real world application in a single container, right? So sometimes if you're running a multiple containers, sometimes you need to tightly couple these two containers. Maybe you need to access same file system. Maybe you need to share the same network. Maybe you need to share the inter-process communication. So even if you're running two separate containers, you can't do it. But within the Kubernetes pod, what they have did was there are some namespace, there are some file system sharing, network sharing, and inter-process sharing happening within the Kubernetes pod. But we can have some common controllability, like we can control the CPU usage, we can control the memory usage. So it's like a balance. We can have some kind of sharing, we can have some kind of controllability. And concept is volume. So when you are talking about running application, we need to have some kind of disk space, right? So Kubernetes volume attached to the pod. So there are different kind of volumes, right? One is the local storage. So it can be mounted using the host machine. Or if you want to have clustered log storage, cloud storage, it can be mounted as volume can be mounted from the AWS EBS or GCE persistent volume, or it can be mounted from the cluster storage at GlassFS or NFS, or it can be a Cinder or iSCSI. So Kubernetes has the volume abstraction. Depending on the your application requirement, you can choose the different volume, different storage mechanism. Other concept is this replication controller. So a replication controller ensure n number of ports for a particular given replication controller. For example, in this, we have four replicas. That means it ensure that there's every time there's four ports running on the this replica. If it is maybe if say some port is terminated due to some reason, if it is down to three, it will auto-gen another port to map the defined n in the replication controller. That is auto-healing capability coming from the Kubernetes. Right? So when you are thinking about your application deployment, you can set up set the replicas count. That is a minimum number of ports that need to be run to make maybe high availability, to make maybe a, handle the load that you the planning session. Okay, another concept is Kubernetes service. So this is like a very very good concept. So so this is a Kubernetes service is a virtual, we can think about virtual load balancer. It is actually the layer 4 load balancing. If you go into the deeper technical detail, it is like IP table level load balancing. So when you create a Kubernetes service, it will create a virtual IP. So when we are creating a port assigning another virtual IP, now service has another virtual IP. And so service can group multiple ports for a particular single service. So whenever we route the traffic to this virtual IP, it will do the load balancing across the ports that assign using a selector, right? So other thing is, so in Kubernetes, you can assign automatic DNS name for this virtual IP. So whenever we're creating a Kubernetes service, we can give a service name. This service name can be automatically generated as a DNS name. Then this will be act as a service discovery within the Kubernetes. So if you create a service called foo, if you want to access that service, just ask access the DNS name as a foo. It will route out to this virtual IP. It will do load balancing among the ports that running under that service. And Kubernetes has several type of services. The one is the cluster IP. So cluster IP is it is bound to the internal network. You can't access cluster IP load balancer from outside. If you want to access this this service, either you need to expose as a node port. That means you can access the node IP and the port assigned to that particular service from the external network. Or if you are running a Kubernetes maybe in a cloud provider, you can make it as a load balancer type service. Then it will automatically get a load balancer routing from the cloud provider load balancer, maybe EKS, AKS, GKE. So they will then you can access via cloud provider load balancer. Your request will be routed to the internal Kubernetes service. Kubernetes secret. So when we talk about the real world applications, we need to deal with the secrets. It may be a tokens, it may be a credentials, it might be a certificate. So if you think about the virtual machine scenario, what we're doing is we just copy these secrets into our virtual machines and we configure our application to use it. Now, in the Docker and Kubernetes scenario, we burn all the dependencies and the configuration into the Docker image itself. So one way is to do this, we can burn our credentials into the image. That is not a good practice. Right? If it is burned, whenever we have to change, we have to change the image. Or whenever whoever can access that image, they can get that credential. So in how we can do that in Kubernetes, there's a concept called, there's a kind called secret. So when we can create a Kubernetes secret and attach any of our credentials, and we can mount the secrets into the Kubernetes pod. So when you are mounting that into the Kubernetes pod, it is mounting as a virtual volume. So when you are mounting as a virtual volume, it never touches disk. It is mounted into the memory. So whenever pod terminated, memory is discard, then you can't access this secret. So that is the best way of dealing with secret credentials or tokens in Kubernetes secret. OK, so the other concept is the namespace. So yes, so we can control pod a container using maybe a CPU level controllability, memory level controllability. The namespace is like a higher level abstraction. So it is like a tenant concept in the Kubernetes. So you can create namespace and allocate, say, I can create only 10 pods within this namespace. I can have X number of secret. I can have Y number of volumes. So you can control your working space by defining the namespace. And also you can define the policies. So within the namespace, you can say anyone can access within the namespace in the network. But outside the namespace, they can't access. Either they have to come via service, or we can limit the security policies in the namespace. Other concept is the config map. So whenever we want to run application, so sometimes we need to give a configuration. So if you look at the 12-factor the proposal, whenever if you want to do a you want to pass the configuration, it should come from the environment. So in Docker world, either we can have to pass the configuration as environment variable, or we have to burn it to the Docker image. So burning Docker image is not good practice. So we need to pass from the environment variable. So then Kubernetes way is we can create a config map. So whenever we can create a config map, we can attach that config map to the particular port. Then it will automatically, like a secret, it will mount it as a virtual volume. And also all the variables that define in the config map can be accessed as a environment variable. Ingress. So I talk about the services. So that is layer 4 load balancing. Now say if you want to do some kind of path manipulation, like URL-based access, or you want to do the header-based routing, basically HTTPS-based routing, you can do via the ingress controller. So you can assign a domain name for your service, then you can, real layer 7 load balancer, ingress controller acting as a layer 7 load balancer. Okay, so the other concept is, so since now we are running up 100 of containers, when you want to update this containers, we need to have kind of mechanism. So one way of doing that is rolling update. So Kubernetes has concept called rolling update. So in this case, so there's a service called MyApp, and I'm running a replication controller with a number of replicas is 3. Now I want to, MyApp version is now running on a version 1. Now say I want to update with the version 2. Then we can use the rolling update command. Then it will create another replica at the replication controller. Start with this replica count is 0 with the version 2. Then it will increase to one replica count and reduce the replica count or the previous replica controller is 2. Likewise, it will increase the new version in the new replica count and reduce previous replicas and until get the fully cluster updated using one by one using the canary deployment. So that's how you can use replication control to update the Kubernetes cluster. Now, rolling update is too imperative. So, but if you define a deployment, so deployment can be handled all the changes, all the rolling update mechanism using Kubernetes deployment. What the user want to do is just kubectl apply your kubectl edit and set the new image name. It will do the rolling update across the cluster using a replication controller concept. OK, few more primitives. Daemon set. So a daemon set, so now I said that, so like whenever we user pass the workload in the Kubernetes master will schedule workloads among the nodes. Say if I want to run my pods in every node. So for that, we can use a daemon set. When I use a daemon set saying that I want to run my pod in every node, it will make sure running single pod in every node. This may be useful, maybe some if you want to run some agent within the node, you can use this daemon set concept. Graceful termination. So by default, Kubernetes is coming with graceful termination. So it is 30-second termination period. So whenever maybe scaling down or maybe rolling update, so whenever Kubernetes master signal to the termination, it will do the signaling. Then you can, if your application listen to that sick term, you can gracefully shut down. If not, it will wait 30 seconds and do the forceful termination. Horizontal pod autoscaler. So we talk about the scale replica count to scale your Kubernetes deployment. With the horizontal pod autoscaler, you can automatically increase or decrease your replica count using target utilization. At the moment, it is working with the CPU utilization. And you can define the min and max that you need to work in the scaling up and down in your deployment. OK, I will do quick few demos. OK, so here, so I am running Kubernetes in local machine with the Docker for Mac Edge. So here, so I have, So if you want to deploy Kubernetes, you have to create a Kubernetes artifact, mainly YAML file. So in this one, this has a simple YAML file. It has the Kubernetes service and Kubernetes deployment. Deployment has the my Docker container image. It will, when I deploy this YAML file, it will create a Kubernetes service and deployment. So I just, I can just use kubectl command. So it will create Kubernetes service and deployment. So if I get the kubectl get pods, it will show all the running pods. And if I get the services, so it will show all the services created. In this time, I created service as a node pod. I can access this deployment within node pod. You can see it has the assigned a random node pod. So if I use the curl command, so it will get the response from the Kubernetes cluster. So I will delete this deployment. So it will delete it. So if you get ports, you can see it terminating. Right? So I have a few other commands. OK, I will get another 5 minutes. So you saw that. So to run Kubernetes, you need to either create YAML files, or you have to use some kind of other tools that help to deal with these YAML files. So like I'm not going detail in this. Draft is a Microsoft tool that it can use for the build to push, build push deploy mechanism. So likewise, some tools are providing external command to run your application in Kubernetes cluster. But if you look at the Meta Particle and Ballerina, so they will provide within the your application code, you can define your deployment artifact that need to be generated. Then you can use that artifact to run your application in Kubernetes. So I will demonstrate another simple demo, my last demo. So this is a simple program written in Ballerina. So basically, I have a service, and this will just print the hello world. And now, within the my service, within my code, I can define using annotation saying that I want to create a Docker image called, in this case, Lakmal hello world Kubernetes dash Kubernetes, and that will create Docker image automatically out of this my this service, and it will going to use create a Kubernetes service with a node port type, and then I can access my this hello world service using a Kubernetes node port. So what I can do is I will just so I have the only bell file. So if I use a wheel, so it will read all this annotation defined in my application. It will generate the my binary and the Docker image and all the YAML that required to run my application in Kubernetes. So you can see it will generate all the YAML files that required to run in Kubernetes. If I just use kubectl run command, it will deploy my application in Kubernetes. And if I use, say, get service, I can get the node port, and I can use curl command. So basically, so that's about the demo. I skip one demo. So basically, the takeaways. If you want to run your application in Kubernetes, you need to understand the Kubernetes primitives. Then you need to choose the best practices with your application concept, either config map, secret, HPA, volume mount. So you have to understand the Kubernetes concepts, and you have to use in your application Kubernetes YAML generation. Then other harder problem is YAML generation is a very harder thing. If you want to do manual handling YAMLs, it's nightmare basically. So maybe you have to think about different tools, different concepts to use create these YAMLs or automate the deployment in Kubernetes. Any questions? No? Okay, I will wrap up my session, so I will get out of my time. Thank you very much.